So welcome to the joint Columbia-NYU-CUNY Number Theory Seminar. Our speaker today is Levent Alpoge, who's actually at Columbia, but lives in Princeton, I understand.
Yeah.
And he'll be speaking on effective height bounds for odd degree, totally real points on some curves.
Thank you for the invitation. And yeah, it's good to be at the kind of home field seminar, but also hometown seminar, although I'm not from the city. But anyway, Long Island is kind of close enough. So anyway, I like starting with this quote of this Byzantine scholar, Hotas Menos, from 1400s. So, okay, so he's going through Diophantus's Arithmetica, which is a problem book. And Diophantus is saying, like, go solve this equation. Hotas Menos solves it. And anyway, he's going through and he gets to the problem just before the one that inspired Fermat's last theorem in Fermat's reading. And he's fed up. He decides this stuff is too hard. And he writes this angry note in his version of the Arithmetica. Okay, so this has nothing to do with what's gonna come except for maybe expressing the frustration that comes with these kind of questions. But yeah, maybe an exercise to anyone listening is, what do you think you would have written if you got to the next problem? No, actually, it turns out the problem that inspired Fermat's last theorem was actually pretty easy. But anyway, so I'm going to be talking about Faltings' theorem. So I might as well say what it is. So K is a number field. C is a smooth projective hyperbolic curve over K. Hyperbolic means genus strictly bigger than one. Universal cover of the complex points should be hyperbolic space. Then it has finitely many rational points over that number field. Okay, this was born as the Mordell conjecture in the 1920s. And in the RTG talk, I talked a little bit about the history. You know, maybe I actually don't see this on the slide. So maybe I'll say, for example, they proved the generalization to all number fields and all abelian varieties of Mordell's finite generation for rational points on elliptic curves. And his advisor, Adamard, told him, that is great, that's fantastic. But what would really tie together the thesis is if you prove the whole Mordell conjecture. And they, he talks about this a little bit in his autobiography, and he says, thankfully, I ignored him. Okay, so this theorem, well, the proofs of this theorem, all the proofs that I know of this theorem are famously ineffective. Ineffective, to me, the standard definition means that it doesn't provide a finite time algorithm to actually solve the equations. So actually, in the RTG talk, I mentioned this, but I like also mentioning this. So in book six, of the Arithmetica, you find the equation y squared equals x to the 6 plus x squared plus 1. And Diophantus is asking for a non-trivial point on that over Q of that curve. Obviously, there are trivial points where x is 0 but and at infinity, but he's asking for a non-trivial point at on this curve, rational point. And there is one with x coordinate 1/2, and then you can change signs of things. You know, to actually see that these are all the rational solutions took until Wetherell's PhD thesis at Berkeley in 1998, whereas Faltings, of course, proved his theorem in the 80s, in the early 80s. So anyway, that should kind of express how you know, this theory is still kind of an art rather than a science, despite Faltings' finite proof. And then, of course, there are other proofs known of Faltings' theorem, but it's the same story. Like Voida, for example, proved it, gave another proof in 1991. Anyway, all of them do not provide finite time algorithms to find all the solutions of equations like this. Actually, I should also say, having mentioned this, that so this is kind of the case of, okay, one way to start is to say, well, we know how to solve polynomials in one variable, even over the rational numbers. That's easy peasy. The rational root test, okay? It's, you know, there are a million different easy ways of solving this. So we can solve f of x equals 0. Polynomials in two variables, not necessarily homogeneous. Well, that's kind of like a middle case. But if you get to like 11 variables, but you can imagine I said 1,000 variables just to be safe, we can't solve them. What does it mean, can't solve? It means there's no algorithm that will take in a polynomial in 1,000 variables with integer coefficients and produce a solution if there is a solution, and otherwise say there are no solutions. There's no algorithm that will do that correctly for every single polynomial. This comes out of work of Matiyasevich and Julia Robinson. The actual bound 11 is something about whether or not I'll allow natural number things or integers, x I to b, natural numbers or integers, but Matiyasevich Robinson. Matiyasevich and Robinson's actual collaboration was about producing this constant, let's say 11 or 1,000 or something. And then the existence of some such a constant comes from work of Matiyasevich building on Davis, Putnam, and Robinson's work. But anyway, it's conjecturally can't solve. Maybe I'll write it like that. Even in three variables. So three variables, not necessarily homogeneous. Otherwise, if we're homogeneous, you reduce to the two variable case. So conjecturally, we can't solve these sorts of equations in generality in three variables. This is you know, one of these, hard to attribute this conjecture a little bit, but it's usually attributed to Matiyasevich and Robinson, and also to Baker, Alan Baker. But anyway, so that kind of shows you that if you add a variable, there's no hope in finding some sort of algorithm. So this is, you know, it's not unreasonable that this is, we don't have an effective proof of fault exists theory. Okay, so I kind of want to get into it. So let's get into it. All right, so I regard this as a really amazing observation by Parshan. Following observation, that you can forget about rational points on curves and only focus on dealing with abelian varieties with bounded conductor and given dimension. Okay, so the observation of Parshan is, given any one of these curves, hyperbolic over a number field, there was already at the time, from maybe even the 50s, a construction of Kodaira, or a finite to one map to MG, but I'll just write to AG, the moduli space of principally polarized abelian varieties of dimension G. And now I say principally polarized, but I like to ignore polarization. So let me just call it the moduli space of abelian varieties of dimension G. Anyway, so in other words, actually, I should also say, I like to say variety, or I guess I said moduli space, but anyway, this is a stack, and I like to not use the word stack because I'm terrified of stacks. So I'm going to talk about abelian varieties. I'm not going to talk about any geometric properties of this moduli space, certainly. So another way of saying what Kodaira produced is Kodaira produced a family of curves over any given hyperbolic curve. So that translates into a map to some MG. And then if you take the family of Jacobians that you get from that family of curves, you get a map to AG. Okay, so this map, let's say this map is defined over Q bar. So Kodaira produced it over C, but everything being algebraic, this map is defined over Q bar and thus a number field K. This map extends to, I get to choose my favorite integral models. So I have to write things clearly. Get to choose my favorite integral models. So imagine I wrote these in like a little bit calligraphic script. It extends to a map of integral models over the S integers for S kind of explicit. You know, you write down the map you write down the relevant polynomials. They have some number of denominators and the coefficients. Throw in all those, invert all those primes in the denominators. And so it extends to a map over the S integers. And I get to choose the integral models. So choose S to be big enough so that there's no subtlety whatsoever in what I'm about to say. Choose kind of the canonical integral model of AG and choose the minimal proper regular model of this curve C over OK, but you know, you inverted so many primes that this thing has very nice properties. But I said the word proper. So that comes from the compactness of the curve. I didn't leave myself enough space. That's unfortunate. Okay, well.
Also, this G is not the same as the genus of the curve, right?
Oh yeah, that's correct. Yeah, sorry. I was using G in the RTG talk too. Let me write capital G. I would write H, but that looks a little too confusing to me for some reason. So writing capital G. So this G is, you can determine it explicitly from the genus of the curve. Imagine it's like a million times G to the fifth or something like that. Some explicit but large thing. Okay. So this gives you a map, a finite to one map from S integral points to S integral points of the AG. Why is that not right? I don't understand, sorry. Say yes. And by compactness, by properness, this is the same thing as the rational points on your curve. So in other words, using compactness, you've reduced, should be G, capital G, whatever. You've reduced the question of rational points, which could have arbitrary denominators on your curve, to the question of bounded denominator, or in other words, bounded conductor, abelian varieties over K of given dimension. Okay, anyway, so that's Parshan's fantastic observation. And you should imagine that as like something is difficult to find, although Kodirid produced such a family. I always imagine it's something as difficult to find as like Fry curves in the solution of Fermat. This is a very serious reduction. It allows, I mean, Faltings has even titled this paper Finiteness Theorems for Abelian Varieties, not saying anything about rational points on curves because he could just focus on abelian varieties. Okay, so that's an amazing reduction. But nobody forced us to use Kodirid's maps. Okay, so maybe this is like an important point, so I maybe want to pause for like half a second. Kodirid's maps, of course, exist, and they were sufficient for proving the finiteness in Mordell's conjecture. But this family of Jacobians that you get from Kodaira, you know, it doesn't have the greatest properties you can imagine for a family of abelian varieties over a curve. For example, you might ask, why not try to find a family of abelian varieties with tons of endomorphisms? And this family that you get from Kodaira could not necessarily have that property. Okay, so the one of the main, I don't know, there's like, this is not really a mathematical step yet, but this is one of the main like steps kind of at the level of ideas or something in the talk. So this is one of them. Nobody forced us to use those maps. And now I want to convince you that there are better maps in existence for at least some curves. And this is where the phrase some curves is going to come, not this specifically what I'm going to talk about right now, but you're going to see that Parshan's observation was sufficient to solve the Mordell conjecture in total generality because Kodaira had produced families of abelian varieties over any hyperbolic curve. Whereas, these great families that I'm going to be talking about, they exist over some curves, but not all of them. So for example, here's a way to produce a family or a kind of reduction, a Parshan-like reduction to a better situation than Kodaira's families. All right, so this is this amazing theorem, Bogomolov and Chinkol. I want to circle it. Okay. So this is due to Chinkol. Okay, so So any hyperelliptic curve over Q bar, what does the theorem say? Any hyperelliptic curve over Q bar admits some atal cover, C tilde, that dominates the single curve y squared equals x to the sixth plus y. Okay, so dominates means there's a non-constant or aka finite to one map to y squared equals x to the sixth plus y. Okay, so what does that mean for rational points? Well, if you are trying to find, let's say the whole diagram is defined over K, this atal cover, the dominant map. This is happens over Q bar, so it happens over some number field, explicit number field. So you're trying to take the K rational points of C, you're trying to find those. When you have an atal cover, well, you don't know that the map on rational points is surjective, but because it's an atal cover, because it's unramified as a map, what you know is that the Chevrolet, oops, I cannot believe I spelled it. Chevrolet Bay theorem says there is an explicit L over K, explicit, such that the map on rational points is surjective. Let me try to put this another way. There's an explicit finite set of twists of the C tilde such that the map is surjective. Let me just say there's an explicit finite extension coming from the Hermite-Minkowski theorem about finiteness of number fields of bounded degree and bounded ramification, such that the map on rational points is surjective. Okay? Just to be clear, I mean, you can find L over K given all this data. Okay, and then you just say, all right, I can map the L rational points of C tilde to the L rational points of this one C6, just the L rational solutions of this one equation, y squared equals x to the 6 plus 1. What more could you ask for? It's genus 2, has the best Jacobian you could ask for. You know, you're in great shape, except you have to do this over a very general number field because you can't, at least if you just use Chevrolet-Vey, you can't control the extension that you get, this L over K, because it's coming from Minkowski. But whatever, C6 is a great curve. And what I've just shown you is that to determine the K rational points on C, it suffices to determine the L rational points on C6 because, excuse me, suppose you've determined the L rational points on C6. It's an easy matter to check whether or not they lift to L rational points on C tilde. That's kind of like if you have a polynomial in one variable, so the fibers are finite. So it's kind of like if you have a polynomial in one variable, checking whether or not it has a solution over L, which is easy. It's like the rational root test for L, one way of phrasing it. And then, okay, so you go through your finitely many L rational points on C6, check whether or not any of them lift. The ones that do lift, take the lifts on C tilde. And you found all the L rational points on C tilde because all the L rational points on C tilde map to L rational points on C6. So therefore you found all the points of C tilde, L points of C tilde. And now you know this map is surjective. So you just push them down to, I guess I should have written. Whatever, I'm gonna write it like this, but I hope you will understand. Not all the L rational points map to K rational points, but the image of the map on L rational points hits all the K rational points. Anyway, there's no map like this, but whatever. So you take the L rational points here.
L be an extension or is it?
L is an explicit finite extension of K.
So how do you find L?
Yes, so here's how you find L. So this map, C tilde to C, is etal. So it's unramified as a map. Let me try to get this right. Maybe it's better for me to not try to get this right and just to say there is an explicit, so thus, there is an explicit S such that, let me call it phi. All points, let's say Q in phi inverse of a point P, such that for all P, C of K, all the Qs in phi inverse of P are defined over a field of bounded degree. It's obvious that it's bounded degree because phi has bounded degree as a map. But over a field unramified, field L over K, let's say, unramified outside S. Let's see, how do you find S? I think you could just extend this map to integral models. And then I think, I'm a little afraid that Chevrolet-Vey may force me to add a couple of primes, but I think so long as this map extends to integral models, S integral models, I think I could take that to be my S. Maybe S should contain, you know, the first 10,000 primes or something, all primes of ramification of K and things like that. All primes above a prime of ramification in Q of K. But anyway, it's explicit. I can if you want, I can try to find a reference where someone works it out very explicitly. But already Bogomolov and Chinkle even comment this in their paper. They say, look, there's kind of an effective reduction from finding K rational points on C to L rational points on C6. Okay. I think I used up space, so I'm going to write here if that's okay. So you can, L is explicit. So you can, and if you found the L rational points on C6, you can just check which one of them lift to L rational points on C tilde, then push them down to find L rational points on C, your original curve, and just check which one of those points are actually inside or are defined over K. Anyway, or believe me that it's easy to start, so long as you have an oracle that gives you the L rational points on C6, it's easy to find the K rational points on C. Okay, now, I guess I have space because I can scroll down. So here's the family I wanted to point out. So the whole point of pointing this theorem out is to point out that there's a great family, okay? The great family is that this curve over Q bar, not over Q, this isn't the canonical model, but over Q bar, this curve is a Shimura curve. I don't think this was ever pointed out, but this curve is a Shimura curve. This is, you can find this curve in a table in tables of Wolfhart of low genus Shimura curves coming from triangle groups. This curve is, you can find y squared equals x to the 6 minus 1 Wolfhart, also not the canonical model, but whatever. It's over Q bar, they're isomorphic. And so because it's a Shimura curve, I'll just say in short, there's a fantastic family of abelian varieties over it. So it's a Shimura curve corresponding to the quaternion algebra, the indefinite quaternion algebra that's ramified in 2 and 3 over Q. And that the fantastic family of abelian varieties over it is the family of abelian surfaces, the canonical family of abelian surfaces over it, which I should say universal family of abelian surfaces over it, that have quaternionic multiplication by some order, let's say one of the maximal orders, probably the maximal order in this quaternion algebra. The order actually depends on this subgroup that I took, but it turns out this corresponds to this triangle group, the 266 triangle group, which is arithmetic, and curve C6 corresponds to its commutator subgroup. This is kind of like a generalized Fermat equation, so it's not surprising that you get 2, 6, and 6. When you cumulate denominators, you get a 6th power there. Okay, so anyway, there are better families in the world. I just wanted to tell you that. So for every hyperelliptic curve, if we're asking about rational points on hyperelliptic curves, and we allow ourselves to work over arbitrary number fields, all we need to do is deal with abelian varieties with quaternionic multiplication by this single quaternion algebra. Okay, so seems like a great reduction, but because I said over an arbitrary number field, I don't know, maybe it's not a great reduction. Okay, but anyway, the key point of this talk, hopefully because I've convinced you of maybe the first step where you look for better families of abelian varieties, is to use modularity in Faltings's method. All right, so now that I've told you about families of abelian varieties that are better than Kodaira partions, I want to talk about, I'm going to use modularity, but it's pretty constrained using modularity in this situation. You'll see why there's a real constraint. I mean, modularity theorems, they're quite strong now, but I'm going to need a construction of motives if people know what that means. And that's why I say odd degree totally real in my title. All right. So anyway, because modularity is best understood for GL2, we're going to be talking about Hilbert modular varieties, just the things, moduli spaces of abelian varieties where you have enough endomorphism so your Galois representations are valued inside GL2. Of course, there's a downside. The downside is we have to pay something for this. What we pay is Kodaira's families suffice to give a reduction from the whole Mordell conjecture for every hyperbolic curve over a number field to this finiteness, the Shafarevich conjecture, the finiteness statement for just abelian varieties. And here, I don't know. I still don't know what curves admit families of abelian varieties over them that are of GL2 type, so to speak. Some do. And I've just shown you that if I allow myself an arbitrary number field, this suffices to determine rational points on hyperelliptic curves, but I'm only going to state a theorem, non-conditional theorem for totally real fields, odd degree totally real fields. So anyway, that's what we pay. Okay, so here's the theorem. The theorem is, all right, let me put it this way. The theorem is that you can effectively determine, there's a finite time algorithm to determine. So that's what I mean by effective. I don't mean that I'm going to be able to write down. So Baker, for example, has famous effective theorems, and he writes down an explicit height bound, and I do not write down an explicit height bound. So, okay. So I wouldn't have written it down in the talk, but it's not like I can point you somewhere and say, that's where the height bound is. I don't work it out at all. And I don't ever think I'll work it out. It's actually, I'll comment on how difficult it will be or would be to work out, but because there is a difficulty here. Okay, so what I'm saying is that you can determine all the abelian varieties A over K that are of GL2 type over K. What that means is, dimension of A is this degree of F over Q. F is going to be kind of the endomorphism, the field that embeds into the endomorphism algebra. So you should imagine, so let's just say F is Q adjoint square root 2. So I'm going to be talking about abelian surfaces that have a square root of 2 multiplication. Okay. So you can, when I write things down, you can imagine F is square root, Q adjoint root 2, and I just take the maximal order. So dimension of A is F over Q, degree of F over Q. F embeds into the endomorphism algebra, K endomorphism algebra of A. So in other words, you can imagine I'm saying Z adjoint square root 2 embeds inside, because you can phrase it in terms of orders. Z adjoint square root 2 embeds inside the endomorphism ring. And A is good reduction outside S. So I'm saying this set of abelian varieties, which is a finite set by Faltings' proof of the Chafarevich conjecture, you can determine if K is a totally real field of odd degree. Okay. I think that's probably a very familiar condition for people who work with Hilbert modular forms, but I will explain to you why. Okay. So you can determine in finite time. And I could, because I don't like talking about stacks, and I like omitting polarizations, so that those two go hand in hand in the following statement. Another way of phrasing this is, or a corollary of this is, all the S integral, you can determine all the S integral points on a given Hilbert modular variety, so long as you're asking about S integral points defined over a totally real field of odd degree. Okay, and so why do I care about this? Oh, actually, I don't say it there. So why do I care about this? It's because I gave myself a little room, actually. So these Hilbert modular varieties, this is a, let's call this G. Where's G? Okay, degree of F over Q is going to be G. And this O is an order in F, let's say. So O is an order. So this Hilbert modular variety, whatever it is, it's a G-dimensional variety, and it sits inside projective space, some projective space, write it with curly H, sits inside some projective space, some huge dimensional projective space with boundary, so this is the Bailey-Borel Satake compactification, boundary of codimension, bigger than one, let's say. So why does that matter to me? If you have a subvariety of projective space that contains kind of enough of its boundary, so to speak, that has a boundary, so that when you compactify it, when you take just the closure in projective space, the codimension of the boundary is, let's just say, actually, I could even say boundary is finitely many, so maybe that'll be easier to imagine. Boundary is finitely many points. So just like in the case of modular curves, where you have a curve, a one-dimensional thing, well, the boundary has codimension one, but it's finitely many points. Turns out these magical Hilbert modular varieties are huge dimensional varieties, but their boundaries in projective space are still finitely many points. So now imagine you have a 100-dimensional variety in projective space, and it's missing one point. Well, whatever. You just take a random hyperplane section through that section of that variety, and that's going to be compact because the hyperplane section intersected with the compactification, the closure is compact. But on the other hand, the hyperplane section misses that point because it's such high codimension. So you now have a 1,000 dimensional maybe? You have a 999 dimensional compact subvariety of projective space. You could keep taking hyperplane sections if you want. You're going to get down eventually to a one-dimensional compact subvariety of projective space. In other words, a complete curve in projective space. So why do I care about Hilbert modular varieties? It's because there are tons of curves. I just produced for you one way of producing complete curves in that moduli space. I just want to scroll up and point to something. So for example, imagine C is inside. This says finite to one, but imagine C is inside AG. The compactness of C inside AG, I mean, the fact that C, a compact curve, is embedding inside AG, was how we reduced from rational points on C to S integral points on this AG. Okay, so it's kind of saying, like, imagine the conductor is a continuous function on your compact set. It's not, but whatever. It's saying that this is the conductor of these a priori K abelian varieties over K is uniformly bounded, actually explicitly bounded. Okay, so that's why I care about complete curves in these moduli spaces. Because the same thing, same reduction works. And you find that to find rational points on these complete curves, it suffices to find S integral points on these moduli spaces. So long as the curves.
Bounds, can you get bounds for the heights of the points on the curve? Because Faltings doesn't do that. He only gets bound for the number of points. He gets bounds
for the number of points. Actually, it's worth mentioning this. Yeah. That's a great comment for two reasons. I want to mention actually that Faltings doesn't get a bound on the number of points, number of abelian varieties. His argument doesn't produce a bound for the finite set in Shafarevich conjecture. Spiro wrote a paper also following a suggestion of Parshin, where he gets a bound, like you said, for the number of rational points on a curve. But it's worth noting, maybe this isn't so well known, he uses the Mumford gap principle. He uses repulsion to get that, because Faltings gets a bound for the number of heights. He says, well, maybe there are only finitely many abelian varieties of this given height. Actually Raynaud gets that bound, but whatever. So Raynaud and Faltings get a bound for the number of heights, so to speak. I'm summarizing a little bit too much, but anyway, what they really get is that they say there are only, 1,000 intervals, small intervals in which all the heights of the relevant abelian varieties lie. And then Mumford's gap principle says, well, there's only an explicit number of points. And then after that explicit number of points, there's a decent repulsion so that you can't have so many points with heights in that interval. Anyway, side comment.
Can you get bound on the heights of the points on the curve?
Yeah, so given this constant, so I guess I should have said, oops, this is the Faltings height, the absolute Faltings height. But I didn't have to say that because you could also take it to be the naive height. I don't actually know what people usually call this, but like the height that comes from theta constants, the modular height. Okay, so what does that mean? It means because the Faltings height and the naive height, there's an explicit comparison between them and they're kind of equal to leading order. But anyway, they're within factors of 10 of each other, let's say, when the height's big enough. The naive height is you take your point inside this moduli space and you put it inside projective space via this classic embedding due to Bailey, Borel, and actually Satake. And now you have a point in projective space and you can take its height. So what I'm saying here is, by saying that you can take the naive height, and get a bound is you get a bound on the heights of points under the naive height, S integral points in this moduli space. And then because this curve is sitting inside the moduli space, and I explained there is a way to find an explicit S, yes, you get bounds on heights of curve, of the points on the curves. Yeah, that's the whole point. I mean, personally, I admit, I don't actually truly deeply care. Of course, I love the Hilbert modular varieties because they do so much work for modularity techniques, but I don't really care about points on Hilbert modular varieties, except I'm after, you know, these sorts of finiteness theorems, or sorry, effective finiteness theorems for rational points on curves. Okay. So yeah, that was what I kind of was trying to explain. Why am I talking about Hilbert modular varieties? It's because they have complete curves inside of them. And for those curves, you get bounds. But like I said above, it's unclear for which curves, I can produce explicit curves, but it's unclear how general this technique is. It's unclear for which curves you actually get, you can run this technique. Okay, so now what do I want to say? I want to say that this sort of theorem is actually not new in particular special cases. Okay, so if I took K to be Q, so I have all my abelian varieties are defined over Q and the order is Z. In other words, I'm talking about elliptic curves with good reduction outside S that are defined over Q. So S is some finite set of, you know, rational primes. Then this is due to Murti and Poston. And independently, and actually in a stronger theorem, and you could argue a slightly different way of looking at things, but anyway, it's a very similar argument, but independently. Still over Q, and for all orders, in other words, for any dimension, any abelian variety of GL2 type defined over Q and of GL2 type over Q, meaning, so I really emphasize over Q, meaning that it's GL2 type with Q endomorphisms, endomorphisms defined over Q. This is due to Raphael von Kahn. Okay, and I'm actually going to explain how their techniques work because anyway, I like it. So I call this the Master-Wüstold/Bost argument, but really you should call this the Reynaud-Master-Wüstold/Bost argument because this is like the isogeny estimates from Master-Wüstolds, but also Reynaud had one well before them. And there's a lower bound on the faulting site due to Bost. Okay, so I'm going to explain this lemma argument now. Suppose I want to find all
but the- just to be clear.
Yes.
So the hyperelliptic curve example explained, does that suffice to also control the S integral points on this Shimura curve, right? Can you do something with the Shimura curve?
That's true, but you have to do it over an arbitrary number field. And if I want to use modularity techniques, sorry, yeah, because I know you know exactly, you're going to understand what I say. I'm going to say maybe more highfalutin answer or something. But the point is, because not just I want to use modularity techniques, which are great over CM fields, but also I need a construction of motives. So I need a construction, in this case, of an abelian variety associated to a Hilbert modular form, for example. But, or, you know, if you gave me a corresponding automorphic form over a CM field, I need a construction of a motive to run the argument. You'll see why. And that's why I have to restrict to totally real fields. Now you may say, well, Shimura curves still sit inside Hilbert modular varieties and maybe you want to take real points, totally real points on Shimura curves. But that's really easy to analyze because Shimura curves don't have real points. They have a local obstruction. It's a theorem due to Shimura. And for example, I think maybe the most commonly known thing is that you can't have an abelian variety defined over, let's say Q, which has quaternionic multiplication over Q. Maybe I have a really fast second to say why. If it had quaternionic multiplication, even over R. So you have an abelian variety defined over R, you take its R points, because it's compact, it's an S1 to the G, G is the dimension. So if you take its first cohomology, Q coefficients, the endomorphism reacts on it. So your quaternion algebra, maybe I shouldn't call it B, D, X on it, and sorry, I said abelian surface. This argument is particular to abelian surfaces. So this is a Q squared, and this gives you a map from D into 2 by 2 matrices over Q. So it's got to be split. anyway, is a theorem of Shimura that there are no real points on Shimura curves. So you could try to run this argument over a totally real field, et cetera, but it wouldn't give you an interesting conclusion for Shimura curves, unfortunately. But yeah, that was the first place I wanted to look is Shimura curves, but yeah, unfortunately it doesn't tell you anything. So anyway, the Musser-Wustold's bust argument. Suppose I start with an abelian variety B over number field K, given B over K, and want all K isogeny factors of B. Okay, so what is a K isogeny factor? The Poincaré complete reducibility theorem says, Poincaré complete reducibility means, so I want all K isogeny factors A of B. It says that B is K isogenous to A cross C. So up to isogeny, B factors, all right? Okay, so that means, so the Musser-Wustold's isogeny theorem actually, maybe I don't know how familiar it is, but I'm just going to use it. So Musser-Wustold's, what it says is, if I have two isogenous abelian varieties over K, then there is an isogeny, let's say B and A cross C, B is given. So if I have an abelian variety isogenous to my given B, then it's, you know, the degree of the isogeny that I start with could be tremendous. What Musser-Wustold say is actually, there exists an isogeny between these two things that's not tremendous, that's bounded in terms of the height of B, which is because it was given, I have in my hands. So there exists an isogeny. Actually, I can just put it this way. Height of A cross C is bounded in terms of the height of B and, you know, degree of K over Q actually, and probably the dimension of B. I'm writing G too many times, so maybe let me actually dimension B. That's what Musser-Wustold said. Maybe people are more familiar with Reynaud's version of Faltings's isogeny estimate. Reynaud's isogeny estimate says the same thing. If you give me the abelian variety B, then I can produce a bound such that any isogenous abelian variety has height bounded in terms of that. Okay. So the height of A cross C, thankfully, is the height of A plus the height of C. And this is where I use BOST. The height of C is bounded below by some constant. I like to write 10 to the 10 for some constant, times the dimension of C. And the dimension of C, because it's, you have this isogeny factorization, is bounded above by dimension of B. So we conclude the height of A is bounded in terms of the height of B only, or, you know, and K and dimension of B. Okay. So all that to show that if you give me an abelian variety, I can find all its isogeny factors because they all have bounded height. Right. So now, having done that, we can find all the elliptic curves of conductor, given conductor. It's actually one line. So this is where you use that you're working over Q. Sayre's conjecture is known over Q. And that translates into a geometric statement. All elliptic curves of conductor N, I should say non-CM elliptic curves of conductor N, but the CM ones are also easy to find over Q. All elliptic curves of conductor N, where did this go? Are isogeny factors of the Jacobian of the modular curve X0 of N. So go compute the height of the Jacobian of modular curve X naught of N, which you can do. You're given N, so everything's explicit. So the height of V is bounded in terms of N. So there's no problem to find all such elliptic curves. Actually, this is actually much easier. Baker's bounds suffice to find, even over any number field, all elliptic curves of bounded conductor. In other words, all elliptic curves with good reduction outside a finite set, a given finite set of places. So there was not really a problem there, but this is an argument that generalizes. This is, anyway, yeah. So we did it. And I want to comment on the geometric statement. So modularity told us only that the L function of E is the L function of a weight two, I almost said Hilbert, weight two holomorphic modular form of level N. The level matches the conductor of the elliptic curve. So this was modularity. That's all it bought us, modularity. But there's a construction due to Shimura of an abelian variety associated to any weight two modular form. I should say eigencusp form maybe. So this is due to Shimura. And that's a geometric consequence is, okay, so let me not skip ahead. The construction is as a quotient of the Jacobian of the modular curve. Very classic construction of Shimura. And so you find inequality of L functions of two abelian varieties, E and AF. And due to the Tate conjecture proved by Faltings, the Tate conjecture for endomorphisms proved by Faltings, it follows that E and AF are isogenous over Q. And in other words, E is an isogeny factor, also an isogeny factor of J naught of M. Okay. So that's how you got the geometric consequence. This is, you know, people usually phrase this as there's a uniformization by a modular curve, mapped from the modular curve to E. So now if you assume modularity, you can prove the theorem. Because what do you replace? I mean, you just have to replace J naught of N by something, and you get Jacobian of an explicit Shimura curve. Let me just write very precisely Shimura curve comma S to mean Shimura curve with level structure. That's what replaces J naught of N. And your abelian variety that you're after, which had good reduction outside S and so bounded conductor and was GL2 type over your number field K, is an explicit quotient of the Jacobian of a Shimura curve. So the height of A, it's bounded explicitly in terms of S and, you know, the number field, et cetera, right? K and S. How do you produce the Shimura curve, or where does it come from? Again, this is modularity only buys you, we assumed modularity. Modularity only buys you an equality of L functions. This is what modularity buys you. So A is this GL2 type abelian variety. All modularity buys you is that there's a parallel weight to Hilbert modular, I'll say eigencusp form, that has level N or level matching the conductor of A, which is bounded, and such that the two L functions are equal. But now, same thing. Hita constructed an AF, so to speak, associated to F. And how do you construct it? I'll say really fast. F is a Hilbert modular form of parallel weight two. What you do is you take that F. It's over an odd degree totally real field. Now people who know this stuff are probably like, of course. So it's an over an odd degree totally real field. What does that mean? It means that I can take an even cardinality subset of the, I can take the infinite places of K. So K is odd degree totally real. You take an even cardinality subset of the places of K that omits one of the infinite places of K. So that's even because I assumed it had odd degree. Because I have an even cardinality subset, or an even cardinality set of places, there's a quaternion algebra ramified at exactly that set of places. So you produce that quaternion algebra. And now there's, I think, Eichler-Shimizu transfer, but Jackie Langlands transfer. You can Jackie Langlands transfer this Hilbert modular form to an automorphic form on that quaternion algebra. And then you say, that quaternion algebra, the Shimura variety associated with that is a curve. It's a Shimura curve. And the automorphic form on that quaternion algebra, anyway, that produces for you something in H1 of that Shimura curve. This is just the standard, this is a pretty standard construction anyway. I think it's due to Hita originally. So what Hita produces an abelian variety associated to such a Hilbert modular form, and it's a quotient of the Jacobian of an explicit Shimura curve. And then again, this equality of L functions is the reason that you see A is an isogeny factor of this guy. So you can bound the height of A. But that assumed modularity. We don't know modularity. As in, what I really mean to say is that assumes Sayre's conjecture. And we don't know Sayre's conjecture over an arbitrary, totally real field. So we got to do something. Wait, that was really easy.
Did it need modularity to go in that direction? Because Like in Shimura, yeah. In Shimura didn't need modularity.
No. You don't need modularity for this. You don't. This part is unconditional and known in complete generality.
It's just
this is the kind of the Shimura.
If you go in the other direction, you need modularity.
Yeah, this equality is where you need modularity. Yeah, and I mean the isogeny factors of this Jacobian, they're all of this type. So, yeah, pretty much you need modularity. So, or like it's equivalent to asking for modularity to say that A is an isogeny factor of the Jacobian. Of course, you don't need. I mean, you could conceivably imagine saying, "Oh, it's an isogeny factor of one of this explicit finite set of things." But let me just explain what I'm really doing. So, I really meant when I said assume modularity, it's really saying assume Sayre's conjecture over this number field. We don't know it, but let me just point out we're also done by this argument. This says that there's a height bound in terms of K and S, right? We're also done if we could say that starting with an A is modular over one of an, you know, maybe 12, maybe we can produce ahead of time 12 different number fields. And we could say A is modular, any A that I'm interested in is modular over one of them. Because then we could go for each of those 12 number fields and produce the corresponding height bound. And then say, therefore, height of A is at most the heights coming from those number fields, okay? So we're done, in other words, if there's an explicit finite set of extensions of K that are still odd degree totally real, such that every abelian variety we're interested in is modular over one of them. All right, now here comes the stuff for people who know this stuff well. So every such A, as in Sayre's conjectures known potentially, every such A is potentially modular, okay? This is a very fantastic theorem of Taylor's. And I followed a paper of Snowden's who actually dealt with the certain questions about abelian variety. So every such A is potentially modular. I'm not gonna write anything below there because I wanna get to the next point. So, I guess I'll write, there exists an L over K such that the base change A over L is modular. So, and actually L over K you can take to be totally real. So there exists you could take it to be Galois. So L over Q with L over Q Galois. So I want to state it here. You can also take it to be odd degree by taking the fixed field. Actually, maybe I'll say it later. I want to get to the key idea. So now you go and look at Taylor's proof. And in Taylor's proof, well, you choose a number of things, but there's one key step, which I'm going to get to in a second. But the key point is, the reason I mentioned Sayre's conjecture is about residual representations. Key point is, this extension L, you can take to be dependent only on forgetting about some, you know, small number of unimportant choices. The important thing is you can take it to be dependent only on this residual representation of A. So, in other words, if you take the mod lambda, let's just act like what is A in such A? A is GL2 type abelian varieties defined over K. Although, where did I say such A? Every such A. So every A over K that is of GL2 type over K is potentially modular. And then furthermore, you can take that totally real field of odd degree to depend only on the residual representation of A mod lambda, so long as something called the Taylor-Wiles hypothesis holds. So long as the residual representation has large image. So you imagine lambda is some large prime that you choose, an auxiliary prime that you choose, okay? So now I want to get to the key point. So there's, if you look in Taylor's proof, don't think I have time to say how it would go if you had like the best conceivable modularity lifting theorems. But anyway, Taylor's proof goes roughly as follows. I'm just not even going to say how Taylor's proof goes, but the key point is that he says he produces an auxiliary variety, also a twist of a Hilbert modular variety, by the way, but anyway, he produces an auxiliary variety X. And I'm going to summarize a little bit. The key point is that you need to find an L such that X has an L rational point. Okay. And to be able to apply modularity techniques, Well, L had better be totally real in Taylor's case. And you can choose it because you can just expand L to take its Galois closure. You can choose it to be Galois over Q if you want. But anyway, I wrote equals empty. I meant not equals empty. So the key point is, so need L such that this given X, which is explicit in terms of this row bar, has an L rational point. And what Taylor uses is a theorem of Morey-Bailly that says that that's a local question only. It says that the question of whether or not a geometrically irreducible variety defined over a totally real field has a totally real point is just a local question, whether or not, namely whether or not it has a real point. So Taylor just has to check a couple of local properties, and then he says there exists a totally real point on this variety, and in terms of that point, you can produce this L, okay? So the point I want to make is, for effectivity questions, so saying anything a priori about that number field over which there is a point is, you know, you don't want to do it. But for effectivity questions where you have an algorithm that could just go and search for the point, there's no problem. That's fine as an argument and for a finite time algorithm, because the finite time algorithm can just start looking through points and it will eventually find one by Morey-Bailly's theorem. Start looking through points of larger and larger height over larger and larger number fields, totally real number fields. Okay, so that's the kind of the key point. So now I have to tell you, there's a little bit I have to tell you about. Everything depended on this row bar, this residual representation, and it had to have large image. That's a real condition. So you choose this auxiliary prime lambda, and you have to choose it ahead of time knowing nothing about your abelian varieties. You don't have the abelian varieties in hand because you're looking for them. So all you know about the abelian varieties is that they're giving you Galois representations which are unramified outside some explicit finite set of places. It's called S. And you have to produce a lambda such that the residual representation has large image or a finite set of lambda such that the residual representation for each of those abelian varieties has large image at one of them. Okay, and this is roughly, Dimitrov does it for Hilbert modular forms, but this is roughly a lemma of Dimitrov. You have to make it explicit, you have to effectivize it, but there's a little bit of a trick. But all the data you have in your hands, you don't have the abelian variety. All you have in your hands is, it's GL2 type with endomorphisms by this order O defined over K and good reduction outside S. So once your auxiliary prime is sufficiently large, this row bar has large image. This actually is, I want to make one comment on this. This is like kind of a standard thing that people, standard type of statement that people use in modularity theorems. It's, except they use density one statements, but those are fine too, because they say, you know, the density is at least 99% in some explicit interval. Oh man, I think there's a fire alarm going on or something. And then the last point I want to make is, once you have lambda, once you have your auxiliary prime, the possible residual representations are explicit because they're representations of the Galois group K over Q bar over K, excuse me. I wrote that very poorly. Into GL2 of O mod lambda. This you have in your hands that are unramified outside S. Unramified outside S and primes above lambda or primes above norm lambda, but whatever. So if I take the fixed field of the kernel of row bar, that's a number field because of this unramifiedness condition that is unramified outside S. And it has bounded degree because it's a Galois field, Galois extension of Q. And its Galois group embeds inside this group, which we're given. So it has bounded degree. So it has bounded degree and bounded ramification. So by Minkowski's proof of the Ermite-Minkowski theorem, we can determine all such number fields explicitly. And then it's an easy matter to determine all possible row bars with large image. So that was the last point. The point is, in other words, we can choose, so the argument goes, I'll just write it here, even though it doesn't have to do with this lemma. Number one, choose lambda. lambda sufficiently large. Number two, produce all row bars with large image. Number three, produce by this brute forcing thing, all L row bars. Number four, Masser-Wüstolz bust for all L row bars. I didn't tell you why you could take L row bar to be odd degree, but anyway, that's all. So thank you. I have slides which I didn't intend to get to where I actually worked out an example, but that's all I wanted to say. Thank you.
Thank you. Does anyone have any questions?
So I got the impression that if you look at hyperelliptic curves, they tend to have very few points over total real field of odd degree. Is that right?
Well, what do you mean by few points?
Except to the obvious points, you don't have any rational points.
For any hyperelliptic curve, I could just take a hyperelliptic curve like y squared equals the product of, I don't know, my favorite x minus alpha I, where alpha I are totally real. Oh, you mean obvious points in that sense?
Yeah, yeah.
Well, I mean, an example of a totally real field of odd degree is Q. And the question about finding rational points over Q already is extremely difficult, even for genus two curves.
Well, I mean, there is
If I take the totality of all curves,
yeah.
99% of them don't have points. Yeah, yeah, I agree. 99% won't have rational points. But if I give you a hyperelliptic curve, you don't know if it's in the 99%.
My question is, does your method shed some new light on these kind of questions?
I think no. I think the method is so crude that, how do you get that result? You use an incredibly strong form of Chabot's method. And Chabot's method is quite sharp. When it does apply, it's fantastic. Ahead of time, theoretically speaking, it's hard to say that Chabot's method will find all the rational points. In other words, it'll show you that the obvious rational points are all of them, because the bound it'll get on the size of the set of rational points is so good that you can't have anything else. So it's hard to say ahead of time, theoretically speaking, but in practice, I think most practitioners would say Chabot's method is sufficient for them for almost all applications. And so that method is so sharp for that reason that it's hard to imagine anything beating it. And this method is so crude that it's hard to imagine it giving anything decent. So I don't think so. Like, for example, I don't even know if all hyperelliptic curves embed into one of these Hilbert modular varieties. I know they all admit atal covers embedding into one of them, but because of this Bogomolov-Schinkel thing. But imagine running this Bogomolov-Schinkel argument over Q. So you give me a hyperelliptic curve, C, and I'm trying to find, I have to find an atal cover, and therefore, first off, imagine you have the atal cover in hand, that's not a problem. Just finding this L over K, this set explicit S will have primes in the dividing the discriminant of that, of the relevant hyperelliptic curve in it. And you're taking every single number field of degree at most, you know, whatever the degree of this map is, even two. Every single number field of degree at most two, ramified at most the primes dividing the discriminant and taking their compositum, that's a gigantic field extension. That's Q adjoint square root P for all the P's dividing the discriminant. You know, it's degree even is two to the number of prime factors of the discriminant, which is huge. And so you've already produced a huge field extension. Okay, it's explicit, which is all I care about. But if you want a decent bound, you've already kind of lost it, because you have this huge number field, and now you have to ask about L rational points over that number field. And, you know, alternatively, a billion varieties of GL2 type, let's say, over a billion surfaces of GL2 type, or a billion surfaces even with real multiplication over that number field. And, you know, if you imagine modularity, you're asking about how many Hilbert modular forms are there of parallel weight to Hilbert modular forms of level some exponentially large thing in terms of the primes dividing the discriminant. And over a number field of exponentially large degree. So anyway, it doesn't look good for the sake of producing bounds. Yeah, actually most methods don't look good for the sake of producing bounds. Like for example, the bound you get out of Spiro's argument that builds on Faltings' theorem. That's also a bound that looks pretty bad for the sake of producing bounds. In a similar way, I think this technique is worse, but whatever. Spiro's technique is better is what I mean. But so this the theorem about hyperelliptic curves, most hyperelliptic curves lacking rational points is amazing. It's amazingly sharp. Yeah.
I feel like it's not quite as bad as you're making it out to be. I mean, instead of working with this in ridiculously huge L over K extension, couldn't you just work with a large collection of twists?
Yes, you could work with a large collection of twists. To be clear, you can't kind of twist downstairs. So you still have to pass through an extension, as far as I know. You still have to pass through. So I would love to work over Q only and then just kind of twist this curve to some y squared equals x to the sixth plus k or something. But I accidentally erased something. But anyway, I don't think you can get away with taking an extension. And once you take an extension, then I think things will start blowing up.
So you're saying that such diagrams do not necessarily exist over Q.
Yes. Thanks. And actually, I think this is the place I learned it. But anyway, I want to point you to a paper of Ellenberg and Haast. So what they do is, I didn't talk about the Shabotykin method at all. But what they do is they using the Shabotykin method, or something that's known towards the Shabotykin method, they prove Faltings' theorem for hyperelliptic curves over Q. And they use this sort of diagram. And so in other words, they reduce the question to finding bounding the number of rational points on this curve C6. But because they're forced to work over a number field, and I trust their algebraic geometry abilities much more than I trust mine, I trust that they tried to work over Q and weren't able to see how to do it. And so anyway, I think it's not easy to see how to kind of twist the diagram to something over Q. I'm not the right guy to ask, but yeah.
Any other
questions? So they have to do all, ask us. Sorry.
Any other questions?
Oh, sorry. Well, then I want to make a comment. They have to really work because they can't work over Q, because I think the Shabotykin method, as it was developed, at least at that time, is that the reason? Had only applied for curves over Q with small rank. And take a look at that paper. It's a great paper.
Otherwise. You said you had a slide with a concrete example.
Yeah.
Can we see it?
Yeah. Here's the concrete example. Okay, I really had to work to find this example. You see, I described like it was nothing that the existence of complete curves in Hilbert modular varieties. I said, Hilbert modular varieties live in projective space. They're missing finitely many points. So you start taking hyperplane sections. I made it sound easy to do that in practice. And unfortunately, this has to do with this me being afraid of stacks and also different notions of Hilbert modular variety in the literature. Unfortunately, people, when they talk about Hilbert modular varieties, are often talking about coarse moduli spaces. I really am talking about fine moduli stacks. I'm afraid of stacks. That's why I always phrase things in terms of the set of abelian varieties with these properties. But if you want, that's why I said I'm not going to talk about any geometric properties these stacks. If you want to do this hyperplane section argument, you either have to add a bunch of level structure so that you have a variety, or you face a stack. And when you add level structure, you kind of add enough level structure that you're past the known examples in the literature where people write down equations. And if you don't add level structure, they only work with coarse moduli spaces. So they say things like, this moduli space is rational, but it cannot possibly be, the stack can't be rational because it's hyperbolic. So what I made it sound like is it's easy to produce explicit examples of curves inside these Hilbert modular varieties. I actually have no idea, besides Shimura curves, where they don't have real points, so almost I'm saying nothing interesting. I don't know how to produce an explicit example of a curve. However, I worked to try to find an example. I should have said this. A reference online for everything I've talked about is chapter 9 of my thesis. I'm just going to write it here. So, chapter 9, my thesis. So I worked in my thesis to try to find one explicit example, and I found it. Take these curves. Let's just say you take, forget A. A is just your favorite parameter. Let's take A to be 1. Okay, so take the curve x to the 6 plus 4y cubed equals 1 over an odd degree totally real field, arbitrary odd degree totally real field. For a very large odd degree totally real field, you know, presumably this thing has very high rank. It certainly has plenty of rational points over totally real fields. Turns out this is another one of these generalized Fermat equations. So it's not that surprising that it's associated to, at least over Q bar, it's associated to the 3-6-6 triangle group. That triangle group is of index 2, maybe? I think 2, 3. Anyway, finite index in the triangle group 2-6-6, the 2-6-6 triangle group. Both are arithmetic. So in other words, they correspond to quaternion algebras, the same quaternion algebra I mentioned before, the discriminant 6 indefinite quaternion algebra over Q. In other words, let me just write it kind of formally. If I take the upper half plane mod this 3-6-6 triangle group, which is acting on the upper half plane, I get a stacky P1. I get like a P1, but 0, 1, and infinity have weights like 1/6, 1/3, and 1/6, respectively, kind of. So I'm just writing formally. And this thing is the Shimura curve, the Shimura stack, maybe, the Shimura curve associated to that quaternion algebra. This curve over Q bar, let's say, just to be careful, is the curve associated to the commutator subgroup of this triangle group. So it has some index, I think 18 in the triangle group, and it gives you an atal cover of this stacky curve that is actually a, you know, classical curve, no weird multiplicities. It gives you like a Riemann surface, for example. Okay, and I just described like there's, okay, so anytime you have a triangle group, you have this beautiful family of abelian varieties of GL2 type over it called the hypergeometric family. And in this particular case, let me call this curve C. C admits a map to P1. I mean, this same P1 you're gonna see, let me call that F, the Bailey map, taking X comma Y to X to the sixth, okay? This has ramification indices, all sixes over zero, all threes over one, and all sixes over infinity. That's why you can see this stacky P1. Okay, if you go to the stacky P1, it's an atal cover. So that's this Bailey map F, and you can produce these singular curves, this family of singular curves. Y to the sixth is equal to x to the fourth plus one minus x cubed, sorry, times one minus x cubed, times one minus f times x. So this is a family of curves. You could take their desingularizations, take their Jacobians. This family of curves is of genus 3 curves, geometric genus 3 curves. So those Jacobians that I said have dimension 3. But actually, there's an obvious quotient map to y cubed, yes, y cubed is x to the fourth times one minus x cubed times one minus f times x. And you can imagine canceling the one minus x cubed factor and then making this a one. So you get something that looks like y cubed equals x times one minus f times x, an elliptic curve with CM. So you're seeing that there's a canonical and obvious kind of isogeny factor of an elliptic curve with CM of this three-dimensional abelian variety. So you quotient out by that, you get an abelian surface. This is the standard construction of hypergeometric abelian varieties in this case. You get an abelian surface, and that abelian surface is the family that has quaternionic multiplication by that quaternion algebra of discriminant 6. But actually, even better, you can see some of the endomorphisms very explicitly. Namely, because the equations are of the form y to the sixth equals something, I write that here, there's an obvious action of third roots of unity or sixth roots of unity by just multiplying the y coordinate and not x. I use x and y twice, but imagine, you know, this, whatever. Just forget about these x and y coordinates. I mean the y coordinate on this family. So there's an obvious action of z adjoint zeta 3, the quadratic order, I mean the maximal order in the quadratic field. But that action is by endomorphisms defined not over k, which was your totally real field, but over k adjoint zeta 3. It's obvious from the coordinates description. And so you see that these abelian varieties, you have an explicit endomorphism defined over k adjoint zeta 3. And so they're a family of abelian varieties of GL2 type over k adjoint zeta 3. But that's not enough because I always wanted to make the point, and I think I made it a couple times, that your endomorphisms also have to be defined over your totally real field. Okay, but anyway, it turns out to be enough to run the argument by being a little bit clever. I see that there's actually quaternionic multiplication over this field by computing the two-dimensional Galois representation and using Fulton's proof of the take conjecture for endomorphisms. Then because there's so many endomorphisms over a quadratic extension, there have to be enough endomorphisms to make a GL2 type over K, over this totally real field. And then I can run the argument. All that to say, I had to do a lot of work to actually find an example, but anyway, here's an example. X to the sixth plus 4y cubed equals 1, or those twists.
Any more questions? Well, let's thank Levent for a great talk. I'm going to turn off the recording.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Oh, I even have a little slide.